since we're in France, we should start on time as the French students do, as opposed to Sweden, where they're always late. But it's 9 o'clock, and welcome to this presentation on Microprofile. A couple words on me. My name is Ivar, Grimstad. I'm Norwegian, living in Sweden. I work as a principal consultant for the Cybercom group there. I'm a Java champion and Oracle developer champion, and I'm involved in the Eclipse Foundation as the PMC for EE4J. As well as I'm involved in the Microprofile community and the Jakarta EE working groups. I also run the local Java user group in Malmo. And I'll put the Apache logo up there since I'm an Apache NPM's contributor as well. So, what I'll go through today is it's going to be quick and it's going to be a lot of code. And what I will do is give you a little bit of background, then I'll introduce Microprofile and I'll show the demo example, so most of the specifications. So why are we talking about Microprofile at all? Well, one of the reasons is Java EE8, or more, what was going on with Java EE8 in 2016. And it was kind of slowing down, and the community reacted, and people got together and thought, we can do something in ourselves as well. So they met up at the Devils UK in 2016 and started figuring out what to do, and Microprofile is one of the initiatives that came out of it. Another thing is that while Java EE gives you a very good platform for creating applications, it's not that good for cloud native support, so we need something that also gives you a little bit more rapid releases and support for clouds. And that is why Microprofile project was started. And Microprofile.io is the website you can go to get started. It's focused on contribution, and this is where you get started. Join the discussions, join the mailing list, and listen to what's going on and contribute. It is an Eclipse project, so it has an Eclipse website as well. And here you can see some of the implementations listed. I think there's one missing there, but there are a lot of implementations on Microprofile. When we talk about Microprofile, we need to talk about profiles as well. So, we've had profiles in Java EE since Java EE 6. And we've had the full profile and the web profile. And Microprofile is not an official Java EE profile, but the first version was a subset of the web profile. And the first version of Microprofile was just kind of let's show that it can be done thing. So just pick the specifications that are basically needed to create a simple web service in Java, which is JaxRS, CDI, and JSP. And JaxRS is a specification for RESTful endpoints. CDI is kind of context and glues everything together. And you have JSP for JSON processing. And when you have these specifications, you're more or less good to go to create a simple microservice. The web profile gives you a little bit more, such as support for WebSockets. You get some UI support for JSF, so servlets, and you get EJPs, JPA, and etc. And the full profiles give you more enterprise stuff, such as batch, SOAP web services, more security, and that kind of things. Microprofile is not an official Java EE profile, but the first version was a subset of Java EE. Another reason for why Microprofile is very cool is the packaging. And if you look at the traditional way of deploying and packaging your applications is to deploy multiple services in a container. So you have your application server running in a data center somewhere, and you ship the WAR file or ER files or whatever your deployment units are over to your data center, and they deploy it into the big application server running there. And only the kind of guys that are handling the server are allowed to do things with it. And the problem with this approach is that, say that one of the services are getting into trouble or consuming some resources, and they will more sooner or later affect the other services who will get into trouble with this approach. The only way to package standardized Java application is the thin WAR. And the thin WAR approach it is that your application is just containing the stuff you need to execute your business logic. And all the platform services, such as security, transactions, integration, persistence, and etc., are provided to you by a container that you have underneath. And this is the typical stack for Java-based applications. You need to have some kind of hardware or virtual machine to run on. You need an operating system, and you need the JVM. And on top of that, with the thin more approach, you have the Java U container that gives you the services your application needs to run, and your application can be packaged as the thin more. What's grown more popular with microservices is the Uber jar or fat jar approach. And in this approach, you have the same stack underneath. You have the hardware, the operating system, and the JVM. And on top of that, you package your application as a thick wall, or fat jar, or Uber jar. And this contains everything you need to be able to run the service. And you typically run it with Java jar. Well, from Java, Java business. And another way of packaging is the hover jar approach. And in the hover jar approach, you package your sort of application server or container dependencies in a jar file, and you have your thin war as a parameter to this. So you execute typically with jar, the container jar, and then the thin war. And if you compare these approaches, the Uber jar, the Java jar, the hollow jar is the same, just has another parameter. The Java EE way will differ a little bit depending on which vendor you're using. Typically, you drop the files into some kind of auto deployment folder, and this name and path differs from implementation to implementation. So if you want to switch from a web server, web logic, or some other server, you have to tune your deployment specs. And then we have Docker. And if you have this approach with the different ways of doing it, and you add Docker to this equation, from the outside, it's the same. So from the infrastructure, if you're running it in Kubernetes or whatever managed system you have around your Docker containers, it doesn't matter what you put in the container, because the container is a container, it looks like, from the outside, exactly the same from everybody. Of course, there are differences in how it performs and how big it is and that kind of thing. From the outside, it's exactly the same. And this is where it comes a little bit important anyway, how you package your services, because of the layering in Docker. So the layers in Docker can be cached. And if you make a change to the uppermost layer, that's the only layer you spot. And a thin wall would typically be kilobytes. An Uber jar would typically be megabytes. So it's a lot more stuff you're sending over the wire just to update a little thing. So that's why the whole jar or thin wall approach may be better, especially for a developer perspective when you use containers. So, let's jump into Microprofile. And as I said, the first version of Microprofile was a subset of Java EE. It supports CDI, JSONP, and JSRS. And it was launched in September 2016. And in July, the year after, we got some additions to it. And the reason why it took so long to get this one out was this was when the project was moved over to Eclipse Foundation. So the version worked to get these versions set up, and it took like 9 months to get the second version out. And this one has the same subset of Java EE, the specifications in the orange here, and it adds a new API for configuration. And let's look at configuration. So the approach you call configuration for Microprofile. And it comes with three kind of default data sources or configuration sources. You can, as a developer, put your properties in a configuration file that you're running in your IDE or development environment. And this makes sense if you have a local database or some other properties you want to set and just be able to configure it yourself. And then you can override these by setting environment properties, for example, in your Docker containers if you run them. Integration tests or whatever, and you can see system properties from your environment if you run it in production or in station environments. So you can override these properties, so any property that is set in the system properties will override the other ones. And if this isn't good enough, then you can provide your own configuration sources. And it's pretty easy. You can put in an interface and just give it a higher priority than the system properties. So if you want to have the properties in Zookeeper or GitHub or database or somewhere else, you just write your own config source and override the existing ones. So far, so good. But it was when 1.5.2 came that it became useful, because then you got more support for the cloud stuff. And you got the health check APIs, you got the metrics, you get fault tolerance, and the security support with the JSON web tokens. And this was launched just a couple of months after the 1.1. So this is where it gets interesting. And this is where I'll download some stuff from as well. The current version is 1.3. And here some of the 1.2 specification has been updated, and you've got some new ones for open tracing, open API documentation, and a type safe REST client. So in the demos, I'll demo all of these except the open tracing one. But Microprofile is nothing without the implementations. And if you remember from EE7, when it came in 2013, it took like 8 or 9 months before we had the first commercial implementation out there. I think it was in March or something that Wi-Fi came with the EE7 support. And currently, we're just around the corner to get the first commercial implementations of EE8. So it's been a while since EE8 was launched in September. So it takes some time to get the implementation out. In Microprofile, it's kind of the opposite, because we have the implementations from day one. And the first version were pretty easy, because you had just a subset of Java EES, which is peel off the other stuff, and you had it running. But we have some more implementations out there. You see the big players like Red Hat and IBM and Payara, Tommy Drive. And you also have some newer, smaller, like Kumulus is based on Jetty, and these launcher from Fujitsu, for example. Hammock, which I think is, I'm not sure if it's commercial support or it's just open source. So you have a lot of implementations out there and you can choose. So, 1.3 connects these specifications, and these are the ones I'll demo now. I'll sit down. So the Microprofile website is where you can find all the information. This is where you get started with your video. One project that is kind of cool is called Jesse, and it's made by a community who's created this on its own time. And this is a generator for Microprofile projects. So this is pretty cool. It is kind of unstable, so it may not work, but. You just write in some stuff, basic stuff, most. That's what I said. Sorry about that. It worked when I tried it outside there. So let's try it again very quickly. I think I can go here. I can go in and I can set the. I think somewhere I can choose which platform. Microphone. Then I'm going to set the basics here. Then I go in and open the sound. Then I can choose, and you can see it supports 4 different implementations right now. So you can just choose which one you want to generate. Generate it, get the file down, and you're good to go. It's just unzip, make it installed, and make whatever plugin there is in hand. Good to go. So this is pretty cool. It is a little unstable, but as you see, if you give it a little try, it works. So it's pretty cool, and it's working on it. And this is something I think should be a focus to get some kind of a comparator to the Spring of Dio, where we can generate the Spring Boot applications. We can have Microprofile. So the demos today is. Super simple. The only thing I'm doing is a hello world. And you can see here, what I'm saying is I have a hello endpoint, and it says do sess and some message. And the message comes from configuration, where I'm using the configuration editor. So this is the only code I have there. I have this application configuration for Jaxrest that doesn't contain anything. So this is the only code I have in my application. The POM file is a little bit more complex since I'm configured to be able to deploy it and package it in most of the implementations. And I also have support for guarantee to Oracle Application Cloud, just by using the mechanism on my end. And I have the different vendors and also the bottom of the Docker. So it contains a lot of stuff. It looks more complex than it really is. The simple thing here is, I'll start with OneFlow, is OneFlow is built out so you can choose which fractions you want to use from the server. So you just define, I want this fraction of OneFlow, and it will build a Looper jar or a Holo jar for me with it. And the way I use it is just to add which dependency from OneFlow I want to use. And in this case, I use Microprofile. And I can use the OneFlow Swarm plugin. Now this will change the name, because the new name for Swarm is going to the Thorn deck. But I don't think they're done with it yet. So, and here I also have the option for patching as a Holo jar. So in this case, I'll do a Holo jar. I don't have the time to go through and show the difference between the Holo and Looper jar, but some of them will be packaged Holo and some will be Looper jar. I also have a plugin here for creating Docker images, but that's not something I'll do now. So I want to build this on a cleaning package and activate this Swarm plugin. We're ready, almost. So since this is a Holo jar, it produces two arguments for me, a jar and a more. So if I go, one run this one, as a Megadesk jar, I go into target folder, and I have the tidy-dig Holo jar, which is the Wi-Fi stuff. And then I have as a parameter the tidy-dig.log, which is my thing more. And I just run it from home. And if you're used to the old way of application server, you have to do some deployment magic to get it done this way. So, well, this one starts. I can go in here and see the hello endpoint. And it says hello, and that is no magic because I haven't configured it, and it just says the default value of hello. So what I also get here, which is one of the benefits of using Microprofile, is that I get a health endpoint for free. I haven't done anything, I just have it there. So you can use it if you're using deploying to Kubernetes, for example. This is your health endpoint. This is your liveness protocol. So you have it. What you also need is some kind of readiness test, and you shouldn't use this one for readiness testing if you're using it for liveness testing. Because then Kubernetes will probably kill your application before you finish doing your readiness test. So you have to have two endpoints. But this one helps you with the one run. What you also get here is metrics. So I get some application metrics here, and I get some base metrics. And these are on Prometheus format. And the base metrics are defined by the metrics specification. So these are the same for all implementations. So you can actually rely on this even if you're swapping implementations. There are also some vendor-specific metrics somewhere. Here, these are specific to, in this case, for Red Hat and Wi-Fi. So if you're switching vendor, these would probably be different. And also, so you also have the application metrics, which is coming from my application. And how did this happen? Here you can see the Clavity REST Hello World endpoint. And it has a total count of one hit. So how did that happen? And if I go in here and access it again, refresh the metrics, you see it's two. So let's see why this happened. And I cheated a little bit because I added one annotation. add the app meter animation, which is a simple way to just have some metrics coming out of the application. And this meter is from the metrics project. And there are more. There are, you can have counters and you can have different things. You can spread out the metrics in your code, get them out automatically to Prometheus, and do whatever you want with it. So this is up to you how you want to use it. You get it very simply. It's just annotation here and there. You can also configure this annotation by giving it a proper name. Otherwise, you will get the generated name as is here from the package and the method. This is pretty cool. So let's stop this one and go to another implementation. And it is exactly the same application, only in this case I'll wait for liberty. I'll use something demos later. So here I have Power On. So they have a Power Micro plugin. So the way I do this is Maven clean package, as I would do the other one. Here I have to just activate this plugin. And the power of the profile. And the reason why I'm doing this is just to sort of show you that I have the exact same metrics and exact same health endpoint and the behavior from the different vendors. So in this case, I'm building an Uber jar. So my application is called a microbundle, which is from the concept. And this is starting up as a jar, you see here as well, and it starts up Glassfish or Power Out and they launched a new version today, or yesterday, but I couldn't find it in the central yet, so it's probably coming out during the day. This is the previous version. And if I go here and look at the, for example, the metrics, you see I have the same metrics. I have some other vendor specific metrics because this is another vendor, but the base metrics are the same. And the Dix SLO is the same. And if I filter on the application metrics, let's see the application metrics there. You see, now I have a total count of one, and if I hit it again, it's two. So it behaves exactly the same way. I have the health endpoint as well. Just have to write it correctly. The health endpoint is there as well. So it doesn't really matter what vendor you choose from your application perspective. So these demos here were Microprofile 1 and 2. So I'll jump to 1 and 3. I'm just have to switch branch here. So, there. So I'm now. The following demos I'll do with Liberty. And Liberty also gives you a Maven plugin that does the stuff for you, where you can say which version you want to use, and et cetera, et cetera. The code now has been extended a little bit. I have the same Dixess hello message, but I also have introduced a birthday service client. And my birthday service client is, this is actually a circuit breaker in this one. So here I'm using the Microprofile REST client, and the way I do that is I create an interface and I use standard JavaScript annotations and just describe the external endpoint. And my external endpoint is a birthday service I created. It's running on Oracle Cloud, and you can put in your birth date and it can calculate your how many days it has to start up, but it's called tomorrow. And it calculates how many days it's left to your birthday. This is a birthday endpoint. There, I'll just start again. So it has the birthday, and I have a date as a parameter. Let's see here. So here is the query parameter for this call. It is a get, it's not the birthday. And then I can write a client where I use the REST client builder, which is from Microprofile, is extension of JAX REST builder, where I can say it's this endpoint and I have this method which I can define in here and I have a TypeScript way of calling this method. So from the developer perspective, I don't have to care about how the endpoint looks. Somebody else can create these interfaces that knows the endpoint and I can just code with a nice interface, and that's pretty cool. So let's build this one on Liberty. Package. There we go. Just have to check that I'm actually not sorry. I'll stop this one. That's not that one at all. Controls for it, it's running. So, if I run the, this one is built as a new jar as well. So if we run this one, I just clear the jar. And this one will start up with Liberty. And if you think about it, if you're in 1999, where thought that you can start up web server in 2 seconds on command line, people would be laughing at you. Right? So it's this is super cool. And if I now access this one is running on 9080. You see, I have the same health endpoint as you accept from the others. I also have the hello, which is now doing Duke says hello, it's 34 days to my birthday. And this is Duke's birthday because if we go in here and just refresh this one, I'm not sure if I'm actually calling this one correctly now. There you go, it's 226 days to my birthday. You have plenty of time to buy me a gift. Duke is only a month away. Assuming this is his correct date, then, which is, I think, is in July. What I've also got here, which is pretty cool, awesome actually, that is, I get this documented for me. I haven't added anything for this, but I can actually have my Swagger stuff here and just try it out and see, hey, run this stuff for me. And it says, Duke says hello. So automatically I have this API documented for me. I don't have to write this annotation if I don't want to. I can add stuff to get more documentation there. But this is a fully functional client for my API. And if I want to feed this somewhere else, I have the OpenAI API specification there. So I get this for free. That's pretty cool. So I think the next thing I'm going to demo is the circuit breaker. So I have this circuit breaker here deployed, and it is exactly the same hello method. The only thing I've added here is a timeout of 3 seconds. So if this method takes more than 3 seconds, I want it to time out. I don't want the time to wait for it. And I also say that if it fails 3 times, I want to delay for 10 seconds before I accept more requests. So just a bouncer request. So after 10 seconds, it will start surveying. And to force this to happen, I just have this hack here to sleep for 10 seconds in the first 3 requests. That's good. Okay. So I think I have built this one, so I'll just run it. In order to just stop this, please. In order to test this, I just need some more browser windows. So I'll go here, and I need 4 of them. And also show you some other things that when it's interrupted, it will print interrupted in the server mode. And I also have here a fallback handler defined. So if a timeout occurs or the circuit breaker is open, this fallback will return, so it will say, sorry, I can't count, if it can count, if it has timed out or the circuit is open. So I can have the clients actually get some useful information from it. And so you want experience like Netflix is down because some of the services are down. So let's go, that happened this week, by the way. Netflix is down for 45 minutes, that's not cool. So I'll just have this hello endpoint for in the 4 browsers, and I'll just execute them one by one, and it will wait for 3 seconds after I press, and then it will time out. So you see, it takes 3 seconds, not 10. And you take 3 seconds for this one, and then the first one comes directly because now the search is open. So no matter how much I refresh this window, it will just immediately say I can't count because, and then after 10 seconds it will let the request go through. But that's the circuit breaker. Let's go look at security. I'm going to just start my server here. So I have this secure Duke application, and it is exactly the same hello endpoint as I've used before. The only thing I've added here is a roles allowed, so I'm only accepting administrators coming in. But I haven't defined the roles anywhere, and I haven't defined any security anywhere. I'm just relying on the platform security. And then I inject a JSON web token. And I use this token to get some information, like the name, the roles, and who's issued this token. And I have to do a little bit of configuration to make this happen. I have to configure the JSON web tokens from my protocol. And in this version, you have to do it like this vendor specific stuff. This is how it's done in Liberty. In Waffle, it would be another configuration. But I think that the version that is coming now supports the microprofile config, so you can configure it in the same way you can agnostic. I also have to have a key store to validate the signatures, so I just shared the key store with my issuer. So if I start this one, yeah. 2 minutes left, so it's plenty of time. So it's up and running, and if I access this one on localhost 6060 hello, it will say 401. And in my log, you will see that there are no JSON web tokens in the request. And if I want to add a token, then I'll just manipulate my headers, and here I have an authorization token with a JSON web token. And I'll just add that one, and I'll go in and refresh this page, and it still says 401. And that is why it says, hey, there is a web token, it is okay, but it has expired. Right, so now I can actually interact with the security stuff and see, hey, stuff is going on. So let's generate a new token and see what happened then. And then I have this demo application from the IBM guides for security, which is pretty cool. You can get an understanding by just doing that tutorial. And here I have defined a couple of users. And if I go in with Alice and submit this one in, Alice will be a user. And I get some information, I get a token, and as Duke says, this is a call to my secure Duke service. It doesn't say anything because it's a 401. So if I log out for this one and log in with Bob, which I happen to need to know that is an administrator, log in with, get the token, and here is a Duke says hello with role admin user, token issued by Liberty. So now I'm actually getting this from my service. So if I go in here, take this token, there we go. Get in here, put it in the modify my headers there. There. Go in to my security application, refresh this one, and now the token is valid. And it says hello wrong with the admin user. So you can see I can propagate the stuff from the JSON web token and use it in my application without configuring this stuff in my application. So this is super useful for securing your microservices. So what I did was to show most of these specifications very fast. There are lots of more presentations coming up on this in this room, following this one. Microprofile 103 is the current version. 104, and thanks Emily for the slides, is coming up in June 20. I keep updating this slide every time I do it because cancel the timer. So, there we go. Oh, come on. So, June 20th, I think it's the target date for their you update a lot of these specifications. Jupyter is also due the same date. It's based on 104, but it also has Java E8 support. And Java E8 has a lot of good stuff. It's a good platform. It's out there. It's been there since September. The first implementation are coming to around the corner. And you've got all these new and modified specifications. Good enterprise guys where the next versions of enterprise Java will be. It's in the Jakarta EE, the working group at the Eclipse Foundation. Jakarta.ee is the website. I have stickers here, so if you need Jakarta EE stickers, I have a couple of microphones as well, so just to come up here afterwards. This is where you find the information, it's microprofile, Jakarta EE. My GitHub is where the cloud view can be microprofile views, and I also have some microservice patterns, which is just, there's certain two can you find it. That's what I had. Thank you for listening, and sorry about 1 minute over. Thank you.